Hello, and welcome to episode 36 of the In General podcast, brought to you by Jurassic Outpost. I'm here with Chris and Nate from Jurassic June.
Hey, how's it going?
How's it going?
Day three of Jurassic June.
Yes, sir.
It's crazy. How's it going, man?
Man, it's been a whirlwind. We've pushed out our new app, Jurassic Jump, and...
It's been
2.5 years in the making, and it's man, it is a ton of work, and
it is finally
yes, it is very hard.
It is incredibly difficult.
Let's talk about that. So so when we were putting it together, like I said, this is like 2+ years in the making. I started with one developer and it stalled out, and so it was like super frustrating. So I had to kind of put it to rest for a little bit, and then I finally found this other guy that was willing to help. And I mean, he is That's Tiny Dev Studios. Yeah, he's a guy. He lives about 25-30 minutes from here, from my house, and so local guy. So we literally spent like, I mean, here recently, it's been almost every night on the phone or FaceTime and or in person, just cranking on this. Like he has a full time job, two little kids, like designer, coder guy at a company, 9-to-5 deal. So we're both kind of in the same realm, and so like we just were working really hard on it, and it's awesome. I'm super thankful I found him. He knows his stuff. It's legit. But as we started making it, we hit level one, and we're like, all right, so literally it started off with all the design pieces, and I have a sheet. I'm going to publish it probably later in the month. It might make even a cool poster one day. It's literally every single asset for every level, and it's like probably over 200 pieces, like every spike and every tree branch and leaf and you name it, all the dinosaur animation. So we got all that out of the way. And then when we came to building level one...
you were like, let's make it impossible.
No. Not by any stretch. But the model was... one of our favorite games was Geometry Dash. I don't know if you guys ever played that. It's super... It's got that addicting quality, and it's hard as crap. And like it took you about like... It took me. I would consider myself a gamer, but not like by no means hardcore gamer. Phil is the guy that runs Tiny Dev, and he's a little more into it. Like he'll play a lot more games and stuff like that. And so I kind of like if he can beat it, if he can beat it, that's probably for like the more elite kind of gamer. And if I can beat it, then it's more towards the average Joe. We built level one. It was a Saturday.
Oh, fuck. Sorry. I got really far.
I got so far and I just died. I was like, oh, I'm going to beat level one.
We're playing right now, man. This game is so fun. But it's so hard. Go on.
Yeah. So it's okay. That's good. I'm glad you're playing. So we spent a whole Saturday building level one. And then the next Sunday, in between regular schedule, of like taking care of kids and I think going to the park, that kind of thing, that just a normal kind of relaxing weekend day. Off and on, I played level one, and I'm like, dude, I kept texting, I'm like, this is too damn hard. like I don't want to. So I was like, well, I really want to find that balance of like addictability and don't want to turn anyone off of the game, because truth be told, right now, it's probably a little harder. Like, it's probably the average Joe, might give up on it, and I don't want that.
118, man. Woo. Oh.
So,
sorry.
118 what? Coins?
Coins, yeah.
Yeah. So, all that to say, I spent that day kind of off and on playing. It's a good sitting on the toilet kind of game. And so...
Totally, man.
Like, by the end of the night, I finally beat level one, and I was like, okay. Like, it's hard. And it's frustrating, and every time I die I want to say bad words, but it's beatable, I think. And so now, literally, I'm not kidding you, I was testing it out on an Android device because it launched on Android yesterday. And I picked up, I borrowed somebody's phone, picked it up, launched level one, and beat it in like a minute. So
yeah, I'm getting quite far right now. I've hit the first egg.
Yeah,
I think once you really, it's missing those spikes on the ground.
So here, it's a memory game, right? So you've got to just, and to be honest, we set it up where there are ads. And to be honest, like, you don't make a ton off of ad revenue. Like, people don't really, rarely ever click ads. It's not, you know, just seeing them, you get like, I don't even know, like tenths of a penny or something like that. It's just, stupid. The real point is to drive people towards, you know, removing the ads for 99 cents or
79p in Britain.
79p, that's right.
I did yesterday and it worked well. Now I have no ads.
and so that helps in the, you know, repeatability, memorability kind of thing, you know. So if you're going and you're like, okay, I need to not jump here, I need to double jump here, I need a, you know, single jump there, that kind of thing. It's just that consistent over and over and over. And dude, when you beat level one, it's like the most, it's the best feeling ever. You're like, like Leonardo DiCaprio on the front of the Titanic. You're like, woo! Yeah,
so, no, it totally,
it is,
man.
It's so hard.
How many levels are there in total then? So
there's 10 levels.
Is why it's good that it's difficult but still
exactly
doable,
that was our other thought was, you know, we don't have it's again, if I didn't say it before, it's a crap load of work. And so we were like, originally we thought, okay, yeah, like 20 levels. And then as we started building, we're like, holy hell, this is a lot of work. And so we said, well, why don't we make them challenging enough to where you're going to spend a good amount of time, you know, on each level. And I would say this, you kind of, I wouldn't say they get harder as you go. They're just different.
I hope not.
Yeah, right. they're all kind of, I would say, equally dispersed as far as difficulty. There's even one, I think level 5, it's called Greenland, and it's one of my favorites, and it's really actually kind of easier. Like, I beat it almost and by then, granted, I had been playing and knew the kind of the flow of it. I've been playing for a little bit, but I beat it fairly quickly. But the cool thing is, too, I don't think anyone's gotten here yet because it's fairly hard.
You'd say?
But if you, yeah. Did I mention it's kind of difficult? unless anyone has unlocked all the levels, which you can do for a small fee, level 4, level 7, and level 9 – kind of changed the dynamics of the game a little bit. Ooh. So it's less of it kind of turns into a Flappy Bird-esque kind of thing. So you're going to go on level 4, you actually turn into a Mosasaurus. And
no way.
You're
wow.
underwater. You go through this transformer and it transforms Randy or whomever you're playing with into a Mosasaurus. And you have to keep it afloat, you know, kind of Flappy Bird style. And so you're going to go through all the underwater rocks and you got to dodge jellyfish and
dude, this is so cool that you've made this. I mean, seriously, like, this should be a licensed JP game. It's do you know what? It reminds me of the Lost World side-scroller, the PlayStation 1 Lost World game. Because
you know what? That's the one I never played.
Dude, it's one of the best games, man. Like, it's really fun and hard, just like Jurassic Jump.
It's really fun and hard.
Yeah.
Like Chris.
You know, this really this really reminds me of Sega Genesis games where they were just like, they did not hold your hands and they didn't like teach you how to play. They just were relentless. There were like Echo the Dolphin was like one of the most difficult games I've ever played, and I for some reason this just reminds me of some of the old school Sega Genesis games.
It's like Rayman.
Where like before they held your hand and they were just, they were tough.
Yeah, Rayman must have been one of your inspirations, because this is so Rayman.
Yeah, I, you know, I don't know that I've ever played Rayman.
What? But Rayman was like my childhood game, man.
So I'll tell you what my childhood game was, and it'll totally make sense to the style and the flavor of this. Well, first of all, my inspiration obviously was Jurassic, all things dinosaurs. That's my, that is our thing, right? Big surprise. I know that one came out of left field. So, and then, my favorite games growing up were Donkey Kong Country,
you bastard.
Yeah, I can see Donkey Kong Country.
Donkey
here.
Kong was really a big influence. So, even from the soundtrack to like kind of how the levels are laid out and kind of played and kind of how we chose what kind of characters would come out, like the water level especially kind of like has this like, man, the dude that wrote the soundtrack for this, his name is Dylan, and he straight up slaughtered it, dude. It is so good. Level 4 water world, it's just a jam. Hold on, let me get a little sample here for you.
Yeah, I was gonna say I've only heard the like intro and first level, but I love
it. Yeah,
I've
only heard the first 10 seconds of the game, so
yeah, I know, on repeat. Yeah. On our website, JurassicJump.com, there you can have there's 30-second previews under the album headline. And then hopefully he's been in and out of town, so we're trying to get it up in the iTunes store to download the soundtrack. And I'm not kidding, like it's like I'll just have it on at work, just in the background. It's so good. All right, here you go.
I'll be honest. Oh yeah, yeah. Go for it.
Oh, hold on. I gotta pay money. I gotta pay myself to unlock all the levels. Sorry. Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, like, as far as a lot of Android games go, there's so much trash on the market, and it really is, this really is like such quality, not just because you're on our podcast right now and trying to praise it, you know, it genuinely plays through like an official kind of game. Man. It's so, it looks so good.
Thank you. Dude, a lot of time and
I remember when you were messaging about like, okay, so what art style do we go? Like,
yeah, I remember that.
Yeah. Yeah. Cause there was a version, like I said, when I started with these guys, originally, the guys before Tiny Dev, we were going to do like a really clean vector, kind of a modern look. And then when I met with Tiny Dev, he was the dude was like, what if we did it like old school 8-bit style? And he kind of did a mock up. And I was like, dude, that's so cool. I just don't know. And I was like, so torn back and forth. And
that's when you asked us, I think, because I went for the vector version.
And yes, I think Chris was the only one.
Yeah, Chris went for the 8-bit, and then when you showed me a level play, I was like, "Oh yeah, I made a mistake."
Yeah, totally. Awesome. Yeah, I pulled kind of a bunch of the guys in the Jurassic community, some friends of mine that are heavy hardcore gamers, you know, friends and family, and was like, you know, these are, it's kind of like choosing between two good things, you know. But
yeah,
in
they
the
both
end,
look good, but I think the 8-bit style really fits.
Yeah, I'm really proud of it. And I think it really does. All right, here, check this out. Here's Waterworld's song here. Yeah, dude. Yeah. Little sample there.
That's really trippy, man. That's nice.
Yeah, I like that.
And I'm dead.
Yeah, I'm gonna be too distracted this entire podcast as I try to beat level 1. Yeah, so I just put it down. I'm like, I gotta put it down.
Nate, you're on your own path.
Gotta do a podcast.
That's right.
That music was great.
Yeah,
man, he
really
he
had
did
a trip underwater feel. So,
it's trying to get onto that. I'm gonna put it down as well because I'm getting too. Too involved. I can't get past level 1, man. In fact, Ryan wanted me to set. He sent me a message this morning. Have fun on the podcast. Tell Nate thanks for giving me Tourette's syndrome when I play Jurassic Jump.
Dude, I'm not kidding. All friends and family.
He just said, "Fuck you, Randy."
So my brother says he just sits on the toilet to play, which will be a marketing campaign I use at some point. like the best game to play while you're taking a dump.
Yeah.
but he says, he goes, I just sit on the toilet and say, F you, Nate.
he really gets
so frustrated.
It's great though, man. And it's amazing you've come out with this, like an actual app from the fans for the fans. And I don't know, it's just credit to you, man. This is awesome.
Thanks, man. I'm very, very proud of it. Working out, it literally feels like, you know, you just never know. I wanted to get it in the hands. We kind of rushed it a little bit for Jurassic June. Like, it's just so much work. Like, it's kind of one of those things that could just never be finished, honestly. It could just be consistently making it better.
Are you going to
always
add more levels?
Maybe. So really, like I said, it was a ton of work, and I have a full-time job, family that I ignored for a large amount of time.
Get away, child.
They're like, who is this man walking in my house? So really what I want is just for it to be like, if it can make, I hear the children in the background. yeah. What I want is really just that it makes enough money and makes enough revenue just to say it was worth our time, you know? And really right now, I would say it helps a lot that the Jurassic community, all the Jurassic fans have embraced it. I mean, I've gotten some really, really nice compliments and just, you know, people being frustrated, but in a good way, saying they love, you know, kind of like you guys. It's like, we love it, but we hate it. And I'm going to throw my phone across the room, but I can't stop playing. And so that's really what we're after. And that is super rewarding. I'd say if we were to add more levels, it would probably be, you know, next Jurassic June. I mean, it's that much work.
Yeah, for sure. But I think that would be a good thing to aim for, especially if it does pick up steam. It has
We've
the potential to. It's a great game. It really is like the new Flappy Bird.
Yeah, that's kind of, it was, so, oh, back to the influences. Donkey Kong was like the old school influence, kind of some Mario in there. Mm-hmm. Really just, as a dad right now, I don't have a lot of time to dedicate to gaming, right? It's killing me right now, and I'm just going to like try and like pretend like it doesn't exist, but Uncharted 4 is out right now.
Oh,
and I don't have a PlayStation 4. And I just actually recently sold my PlayStation 3. And so I can't even play old Uncharted right now. So, those are my like favorite types of games, but I would only play, I played those when I don't think my kids were born yet. And so now I don't have much time to dedicate to games. So up in our kind of,
thing
bonus
is,
room.
What's with that? Those games is you can usually get past level one. Now, right now, I am struggling. No.
Yeah. Dude, I'm telling you, there's you, if you go on our Twitter stream, you go on our Insta stream, we've got, like, I'm just reposting and retweeting every time someone beats a level. Because it's like the best feeling. You're like, you just wanted to, you know, pull your hair out, and then all of a sudden you're like, wait, I did it. I freaking did it. I would say, word of warning, on level one, at the very end, at the end of each level, there's a little sign with an arrow. That means you're like really close, okay? So if you haven't seen the sign yet, you're probably not close. But if you see that at the end of level one, and also there's playthrough videos on our YouTube channel. So if you want to see how the levels lay out, like what you're doing wrong, go check out our YouTube, Jurassic June. We've got a handful of videos on there.
Okay, that's probably quite handy for level one.
We've beaten all the levels, just not recording. And yes, we made them difficult enough to where when we're recording them, we don't always beat it. So we have through level 4 or 5 up there. So you can see literally the whole gameplay. The next level after that, after level one, is Lava Land, and it's going to require you to be kind of patient, because you're going to have to double jump, and then you're going to have to not jump and drop down a level. And that was kind of inspired by Geometry Dash, if you've ever played that. It's really, like, if you jump at this certain section, you're going to die. You're going to get hit by a lava ball or whatever. So, yeah, man, it's...
I'm sorry, but the bit that gets me is the spikes that come from above.
From above. Like, you're just like, what? Where do these guys come from?
So yeah.
That is that part there. That's where the YouTube video might be able to help. Unless you're like my boss who texted me and was like, yeah, I just watched that how-to video and I'm never going to beat this game. I was like, okay, I'm sorry. Don't hate me.
You're fired.
Yeah. And you're fired. No, the that part specifically there is you have to kind of jump. You have to drop down, then jump three times, basically. So you're going to jump.
I've
once.
Got past it once, but now yeah. because I'm thinking about it, I can't get past
totally,
it.
Totally, totally.
Yeah. What have you done here?
I know. So here's the other thing. We because we were really just stressed and trying to get everything, you know, we weren't even fully ready on June 1 because all our in-app purchases were not working on the Apple Store. But I knew how important it was, you know, Jurassic June. It's the month to be a Jurassic fan, right? So I was like, it has to be. Like, if it goes in Jurassic July, that's a fail. And so so we had some other ideas, and we still might implement. It's just kind of, again, finding the time. Like, for example, my three-year-old loved the game when it was just a endless runner. There was no spikes. You couldn't die. And it was just a couple platforms here and there. And it was really just a test functionality of jumping and double jumping and that kind of stuff, and he loved it. And then when we actually built level one, he was like, "Daddy, I want to play your dino game." And I was like, "Okay."
Good luck.
And so, and then he tried and he was like, this is too hard. And I was like, sorry, buddy. So my thought is, eventually, sorry, not only did I ignore you for the past 3 months, but now you can't even play my game. that being said, hopefully in a future update we're gonna be releasing like a kind of a practice mode and or tutorial mode.
That's a good idea. Like a level like playthrough without spikes.
Yeah, that kind of thing, to where, you know, you can kind of get the rhythm of it. But like I said, man, there's at least 20-30 people that have beaten level one already.
No, that's great. I think as well, because it makes the game last longer.
Right.
Because you get frustrated, but then it's so addictive that you come back. You know, I will be on the. It's like the basketball game on the Facebook app. You remember that?
I don't know.
Really, guys? So the Facebook Messenger app. If you post a basketball symbol, and then click it once it's posted, like in a chat, you can then play basketball within the app.
Wait, this is a current thing?
This is a current thing, and it's incredibly addictive. I was at work for 12 hours, and I'm pretty sure 10 of those hours were dedicated to basketball. It's really hard.
That's awesome.
I'm
trying it right now.
Have you guys not seen that before? I think I thought
how
it
do you
viral.
Post a basketball symbol in a Facebook chat?
Oh my gosh.
What the hell is that?
Nate, it's so fun. I'm going to...
Oh my gosh. This is awesome. Ooh, I just made one.
I think my high score was 63, but the net starts moving and everything.
Dude, this is a brilliant little Easter egg.
I'm surprised you guys haven't seen this.
I don't even know how to make this happen. I'll
go in our chat that we've got now.
I just sent a basketball to our chat, and you type
just click it
the or hit the basketball. That's crazy.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Oh, yeah, but anyway, it's like that. It's super addictive, and when you lose, you throw your phone away, and then you come back to it. Yeah, I can do it this time. I'm going to beat Jurassic Jump level one.
Yeah.
And, you know, 10 seconds in, and you've crashed, and your phone's smashed. And
yep.
Do you know what? I can beat Jurassic Jump level one. Yeah, sure.
Dude, I'm telling you, it is. It's a very, very cool feeling when you've beaten it, and you're like, it literally... I was there, and me being like co-creator of the game, I'm like, dude, this is too hard. Like, I don't want You know, I'm always trying to be the voice of reason. I'm like, I don't want to turn anyone away. And truthfully, I think like that kind of practice mode will help deter some of that as well. You know, like, I really would hate for people to pick it up and be like, nope, too hard, and just, you know, delete the app.
It looks so good. This is what I was saying before about how it looks like a genuine app. You know, it doesn't look like one of those cheap games that that people throw together and put on the App Store, or especially the Android Store, or, you know, Google Play is kind of riddled with bad games. Yeah. But it doesn't look like one of them.
It doesn't play like one either.
No, it feels real. It feels fluid.
I appreciate that, guys. Like I said, well, maybe I didn't say. Like, I am a graphic... maybe I didn't say, but I'm going to say it right now. I'm a graphic designer by trade, so really what's most important to me is that it looks amazing, you know? And then that's why it was such a good partnership with Tiny Dev, because those two guys were very technical and very – it was cool because this guy, Phil, he's got a really creative eye as well, an eye for design, but also very technically savvy. And so, you know, both sides of the brain – running on full steam. You know, for me, I'm super creative, and so I wanted to make sure everything looked really, really good, and everything was consistent throughout the whole thing, and really everything looked polished. And so even like down to the map, like the map came kind of a little bit later. That's what she said, I guess. So we kind of had a little, for any Jurassic nerd, they will kind of understand the tie-in here, the nod to Jurassic. We wanted to steer clear of any copyright infringement, anything like that. You know, we wanted this to be our own thing, fully, like literally every single dot in the game I've created, you know? And so, but, you know, we have to have some nods to our favorite franchise. So the... island is called Isla Saltar, which is nice. In Spanish, Jump Island. So,
oh, that's really cool, man. That's really cool.
So it's, you know, those fun little touches that were like we could kind of add to it, and yeah. So, dude, I hope everyone loves it. You know, I wasn't afraid. Well, I'll take that back. I still am a little nervous. Like, we've gotten some tough reviews because it is hard. You know. Yeah. I knew that I really wanted to do this for our community, the Jurassic June fans, the Jurassic Park and / World community. And, you know, we did this for them. And I knew that they would be a cool, you know, almost even like a beta test, you know, for the game, and give us honest, brutal feedback. And really...
Sorry, my dog is... acting bad. Shadow, come here.
But yeah,
it is. Do not eat my Nintendo.
It is. It's a great thing. I mean, no one's ever done this before. At least, you know, from the fan side of things, the Jurassic fans, we've never seen an app like this, especially a game that's going to be. I mean, people are going to play this for a long time, man. It's great.
Well, I hope so.
Yeah, it's a great way to launch Jurassic June. Now. I think I said this on our first podcast. It's the third Jurassic June, right?
It is. It is indeed.
Hell yeah.
It started 3 years ago, you know, kind of as a joke between some of the Twitter Jurassic peeps online. You know, it was on May the 4th, Star Wars Day. We said, hey, you know, why don't we have anything for Jurassic fans, you know? And so that was kind of birthed out of that. And then fast forward to last year. Dude, Chris, what are you doing over there, bro?
I was gonna say, what is that sound, man? Chris,
what, hold on, what?
Chris is like renovating his room over there.
Yeah, he's like, I knew I had something to do this morning.
Easy, Bob Vila.
My dog started tearing things up, so I had to go chase him.
Oh,
did you best. Name your dog after Homeward Bound?
Shadow.
No.
Dude, Homeward Bound, man. What,
dude,
a great
how about
movie.
That right there.
Yeah.
That's probably one of the first I cried to.
Yeah.
That
dude.
One and Old Yeller. Oof, heavy stuff.
Oh, I've never saw that.
You never saw all the other?
No, just saw Homeward Bound, and I watched it again. Well, I woke up hungover, and my girlfriend had it on, and it was a weird thing to wake up to, like
hungover like, bound.
Yeah, yeah. It was. It's a great movie. It really is so funny.
I'll give you a spoiler alert for Old Yeller. Doesn't quite end as well for him as it does Shadow.
Oh, that's brutal. It's not something I want to watch. I'd rather watch the Beethoven movies or something. You know, just dogs
Dude,
having a great
hey,
time.
Oh my God. Speaking of, when I was little, the first time I ever went to see Jurassic Park, the first time it was in theaters, my dad took me and my little brother. And we had to leave because we were too scared, literally after the first raptor scene. And we went to go see Beethoven.
Wow.
The worst. Flash forward
20 years later, and you've made Jurassic Jump.
That's right.
A very difficult game.
Right. We're actually coming out with Beethoven Jump next month.
No. Oh, boy.
That's the easier version. That's the simple one.
Can't wait. Beethoven July.
But yeah,
it's gonna be all the rage.
but that's funny, man, that you were scared of the original film, though, right?
Do you hear that small velociraptor in the background, also known as my daughter? She's shrieking. I don't know why.
Well, I don't actually.
Anyway,
all
guys,
the mic is up, so I can tell.
Good.
Oh, I got past that. So I reached a 50%. I saw the 50% icon, and then I crashed.
Yeah.
I hit some spikes.
Oh, man.
What have you done to me, man?
Relentless.
It's the first time I've sweat on a podcast. I'm actually sweating right now.
I wonder how many people that aren't, like, hardcore Jurassic fans that are just kind of stumbling upon the game are like, oh, okay, this seems cute, this seems fun, oh, this cool dinosaur's Jurassic Jump, and then they're just like, this is so hard, and they don't even know who to yell at.
They don't know who to yell at. We know who to tweet at Jurassic
June. That's right. No, they know what to say. They go to the reviews and leave a mean comment.
That's it, guys. If you're a Jurassic fan, make sure you leave a positive comment.
Yes, go ahead.
Because, I mean, yeah, even if the game is difficult, it is very fun. You can see all the effort that's gone into it. I mean, Nate's the guy behind it. Leave him a positive review because there's only going to be more.
Yes.
Unless you really, really, really hate the game for some obscure reason, then I guess you're entitled to leave a negative review. But don't.
The best one was the guy that, or you know, it might have been a kid or something like that, and he said, this game's really hard, but I like it. 5 stars, but then he clicked 1 star. I was like, come on, bro.
Best of both worlds, man.
Help a brother out. Yeah. If you would leave a good review for us, yes, it's challenging. Yes, it's difficult. It's supposed to be. And, you know, like I said, by and large, all the Jurassic community, I knew, they're really cool. Like, they know we did this for them, you know? So, like, they know all this hard work was for them, and they were going to be that kind of launch pad for the game. And so, by and large, it has been a love-hate relationship, but at least...
Oh, man, I got to put it down. I'm sorry.
That was a dinosaur, I think.
Oh, stressful. Stressful.
It is. But, dude, you'll do it. You're going to do it. You can do it.
I can do it. talk about the rest of the month, man.
Yeah. So we're going to have a couple more giveaways. We launched a Twitter giveaway, simple retweet and follow kind of deal, kind of the bread and butter of how Jurassic June all started. And then we're going to do a couple, we'll do an Instagram specific, Facebook exclusive, that kind of thing.
Nice.
The big thing is, another kind of fun thing is every night, it's my goal to do a recap of Jurassic June that day. And so just kind of talk through kind of what's going on. So last night I did one.
Did you do one last night in the end?
I did.
Oh, man.
It's okay. I'm trying to sync up all these time zones. it's quite a feat. The main problem is... I have to do them after I get the kids to sleep. And I want to make sure that, you know, it is truthfully kind of near the end of the day for everyone. But yes, some of the overseas folks might be already passed out. So My bad. But you can go and watch them. So I did the first one on Facebook Live. It was okay. It's really limited. I had to do it on my phone. It looked kind of janky. I did the first one last night on YouTube and their live streaming service. And so it's up on our YouTube. I just kind of rant and rave about how frustrated I was with Android and how I'm sincerely praying for everyone who uses a device like that.
I'm having a great time, buddy. I'm playing right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, you're good. You're set. No, we just had a frustrating time getting it to there. So anyways, it's going to be a daily recap of anything that happened. I'm going to try and highlight some fans, some cool art that has been created, just whatever happened that day, just to kind of try and, again, like, anything we do is just to give back to these fans in this community and build more.
It's a great community, man. It's filled with amazing people and absolutely very talented people. I mean, and you've highlighted it this month. You know, you've done this game, and then you get all the people submitting their artwork, which is it just stands out. Yeah. It really is iconic. And you've got Shannon Shea coming in, and because he jumped on Jurassic June very early in the first year,
he
right?
Did. Yeah. So which the first, very first one, it's kind of simultaneously happened. He started the hashtag 30 Days of Dinosaurs. The end of May of 3 years ago, sorry. And then I started Jurassic June, and
they've just synced together.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it worked perfect. And now he's got a Jurassic June t-shirt, and he's all about it. He's a super great guy. For those of you don't know, he was one of the puppeteers, animatronic guys
Sandwiston Studios. He actually he was involved with the baby Triceratops, which was cut from the first film.
I got past it! 50%. Jesus Christ!
Wait, did you win or?
No, I I preemptively celebrated. I was getting through the 50% tunnel thing that Nate put in there. You bastard.
I know, man.
This is
it's
so
a pain
hard.
Trump. Dude. Right,
level one.
Okay.
Sorry. Go on. So, continue. Yeah.
Anyway. I cannot. It's my goal to beat level one before June is over. Like, that is like my commitment.
That's what somebody just tweeted me. Because I posted this morning. I said, day three, what are your plans? And, Spaceman Spooky, shout out to Spaceman Spooky.
Yeah, I love that dude.
We gotta get him on the podcast sometime.
He's definitely funny, man. He's a funny guy. I wonder if that will translate to podcasts. I don't know. Maybe it will. Maybe it won't. But he goes. I said, "What are your plans?" And he said, "Day 3 through 20 will consist of level one of hashtag Jurassic Jump."
Yeah, it will. I mean, my intention is to complete it by the end of this podcast, but I can already tell you that is not going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, hey, maybe like it'll be like a very triumphant moment, but like. How
I keep
know
getting
you
further, but then you have
we'll have
level
to see proof
10...
if you beat it, actually.
I will screenshot. To be honest, I'm not screen recording right now, and I don't want to just fill up my phone with screen recordings failure. But if I complete... Because you seem to get better each time, and you do. It is a memory game. You do learn when you have to double jump. I remember that tweet, Nate, when the guy was like, that I forgot who tweeted, but he was like, "Guys, you can double jump." And I was like, oh, shit.
I know.
I didn't know for my first, like, 20 minutes.
I know. Freaking A. We filed this one under dadgummit. We ran out of time. Same with the trial level, that kind of thing. There's other couple pieces we missed. Like we need probably instructions that, hey, on level four you change to a Flappy Bird style. Just a little, kind of minor / major things. But literally we saw we were like, crap, we didn't tell people that you could double jump. I'm getting text, you jackass.
Dude, old school games didn't tell you this stuff.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Old school video games, they just threw you into the game and were like, good luck, figure it out.
I would love to blame it on that and say that was our style. But the truth be told is this is our first freaking rodeo. So, like, we're kind of learning as we go as well. Like, trying to figure out how to get, everything.
It's difficult, but it's fun.
Yeah.
I left the review on the marketplace, by the way, for you.
Yeah,
I appreciate that. I appreciate it. Did you guys see there was one? Let's see. I have to find it real quick. it said something like, it was better than The Lost World. This game is better than Lost World.
Wow, you know, they are incredibly incorrect. I'm so sorry.
on June 1st, they added Jurassic Park, The Lost World, and Jurassic Park 3 to Netflix. So I said, what the hell? I'll do a marathon. I put on Jurassic Park, obviously great. Lost World, loved it. It took me like 5 hours to finish Jurassic Park 3. I had to keep pausing it and just find something else to do. Like,
I find it very fun.
It's so boring. It's like action without any substance, and it drones on and on and on, and I can't stand any of the characters.
Lost World? And,
no, JP3. Three.
Okay. Nate, you'll have to understand, The Lost World is possibly the greatest game. No, not game. See, I'm playing a game. I'm so greatest movie
ever made.
Put it down,
man. Put it down.
No, I'm gonna complete this. I'm gonna win. Go on, Chris.
Lost World's actually a good movie. It's not like as good as Jurassic Park, but it has some of the best sequences in the films. The trailer attack sequence is probably like the second or third best sequence in out of all the films. I'd say it goes T-Rex breakout from the first movie, Raptors in the kitchen from the first movie, and then the trailer attack sequence in The Lost World. And I'm talking about action or scary sequences, not like, you know, fun or beautiful sequences or whatever. But that sequence is so well done.
Chris, you forgot then, one.
Which one am I forgetting?
Probably one of the best ones. Alan.
Alan.
Best moment in the franchise. The raptor that Dr. Alan Grant has never seen before.
I can't.
Yeah. It's so bad.
You know what I can't believe is, like, it. I didn't realize that raptor's hands were on the seat in front of it until it was like
he's
last
like
year.
Schoolboy.
I was watching Alan. And realized that his hand was sitting. Alan.
Dude, my buddy at work and I will just sit there. We've got a friend that is at work, and his name is Ian. And so when he walks by, we just go, Ian,
with your hands up. That is, that scene is. I love the bit where he wakes up and the plane looks like, you know, it's heading down through some thick cloud and it's like a storm and he's freaking out. I like that. It's the moment that you see the raptor. It's like, oh god.
I think the issue is it's supposed to be a talking raptor. I think if he just would have woke up and he had dreamt that they had landed and there was he was alone and there was a raptor staring at him, it would have been a really cool sequence.
Down the runway.
And then he hears his name. And then he hears his name and the raptor doesn't speak. It hears his name and it just wakes him up.
I gotta wonder who greenlit that idea first, because they should be punching the judges.
Joe Johnson directed Jurassic Park 3 like a 90s family movie, not a Jurassic Park movie. And so,
everywhere you look, there's a raptor.
It was more like the Beethoven or like other types of movies like that.
Totally.
It was very cheesy. I love Joe Johnson's movies. I do not think he did a good job on Jurassic Park 3. I think that there is a great sequence in it, though, and I think it's the aviary.
The plane sequence with the Spinosaurus and stuff. I think it's good.
I think it's like it should be good, and it's just like you're watching, you're like, I don't care about these characters. It's filmed poorly. Where they have the best animatronic that's probably ever been made in terms of technical feats, and it looks like a museum animatronic in terms of the way it's moving and filmed, and the camera motions are just swinging back and forth. Who made this? I don't know. It looks like behind the scenes footage turned into a movie.
See, what my frustration with it is, and I guess this even is factual, even with Jurassic World being out, is what you just said. It's got the best animatronics. It's got the T-Rex. It's got the Spinosaurus. Like the
some of the best CGI as well.
Yeah. Yes. I agree.
Yes, some of that
flawless.
CGI is fantastic.
It's just the story that just broke down, and you're like, oh my gosh. Like,
and when you learn about
this, had so much potential.
Learn about like the original script, and you learn about the troubles they had during production, there's no wonder it turned out the way it did. But I honestly, you know, the original script seemed much more worked out, and they claimed in interviews that it just wouldn't have worked, and there were so many things that weren't clicking. Yeah, it must have been bad, but
like it sounded like it had a better story concept, But the like they on paper they probably like someone threw out this really great concept and then on paper it just must have been a really bad script.
They said it just didn't. There were so many things that didn't connect and didn't work, and they were trying to work them out. And in the end, they just scrapped it and they went for the safe option, which was David Koepp, who wrote the first two, suggested a rescue mission. Boom, Jurassic Park, let's do it. I think that's what really happened, and it is a shame because you can tell with Jurassic 3 that there's so many elements to it that feel like part of a much greater story. The aviary sequence is, like Chris said, it's one of the best.
That's one of my favorite sets in any Jurassic film is that aviary, because it's just so freaking
it's
spooky.
Done so well, it's got that perfect nostalgic kind of historical JP InGen feel to it as well. Like, you know, this abandoned aviary, you don't know what the hell is down there. And in the original script, apparently raptors snuck in overnight.
That would be cool. And on top of that, though, Joe Johnson directed the hell out of that scene. I feel like he did a pretty poor job directing most of that movie. But then the aviary, I'm being blunt, but I'm being honest. I think that he's a good director. I just don't think he did a good job with Jurassic Park 3. But he directed the hell out of that aviary sequence.
Well, that's because
you could tell they planned it out. That you could tell that they had they probably had previs. They probably had great.
They did. Apparently, they had
the rest of the film. I don't think they did. I think that they just kind of made it up as they went along. But that aviary sequence, it was good. I honestly think Jurassic Park 3, with Joe Johnson on board and everything along those lines, could have been a good movie if they delayed it by a few months and really made sure that they had something there.
It almost was a good movie, as you saw throughout. And yeah, you're right. Like, apparently, like me and Assis and... we're both very... Like, we love that nostalgic JP3 feel, you know, going over all the old news and rumors and stuff. And we've been looking recently, and it really does seem like what happened was they had storyboarded and planned out the whole movie, and they'd already building sets, as we know. That's why the aviary sequence came off so well, because they pretty much like saved all the storyboards they did for it and kept going. The rest of the movie was completely different. And it wasn't storyboarded. They were writing as they went.
There are some other issues, like when...
You can really see where, like you said, you can really see where Joe Johnson and Jurassic would have worked well with the aviary sequence. That bit where
I feel like
is it Amanda walking along the, you know, just as Eric's gone off, and you've got Amanda just looking into the sort of misty darkness.
Yeah, and then Grant
the tension
finds
there,
and then Grant finds the droppings, and then you just get that, oh my god,
yeah,
it's a giant birdcage, and it just, you know, and you as a viewer already kind of figured that out, honestly. But then that entire sequence, that's the first introduction to pteranodons as a threat in the Jurassic series, and really the first real introduction to them other than The Lost World, which, by the way, I love that scene, and I love that design. It's my favorite at the end of The Lost World. But it's really your first introduction to the pteranodons as a character, and it's really well done. They're very, very monstery. Not as monstery as Jurassic World, but they're very monstery.
I love the pteranodons in JP3, man.
Yeah,
sequence is one of my favorites in the franchise.
They just seem like these birds that have been cooped in. They're going crazy. They're it's a really cool sequence.
Yeah, it really is. I think that's true Jurassic Park as well. I think, like you said, the pteranodons in JP3 or Jurassic World, it's definitely the ones in JP3.
And the scenes with the raptors in Jurassic Park 3 were pretty good. The scenes with the people interacting with the raptors weren't very good, but the scenes with the raptors were really good.
I liked the way they evolved the raptors in JP3. When Grant's realizing that they really do communicate, they have their own language. That was the perfect like evolution past Lost World. Because in Lost World, you know, in JP they talk, but not much. They have the interaction in the kitchen, you know, when one goes to bite the other one. In Lost World, you have a bit of communication, but JP3, they really, like, you know, he's calling for help. That's such a JP moment. It really is. I love that scene.
Yeah, it had tons of potential for sure, and
wrong. They needed to do, after they filmed that movie, they should have probably pulled a Rogue One and said, let's go in for a month of reshoots. So Jurassic Park 3, it has a lot of potential. It did have a lot of potential. It's just I don't find it very enjoyable, unfortunately. Like, there's one or two sequences that I find enjoyable, and it's got a lot of great actors, but, I mean, none of their characters, like, even Grant, I don't even like Grant very much in Jurassic Park 3, and that's a feat. Like, Grant is just kind of not great, although he's still the best part of the movie.
Yeah, I like him in it. I don't like what they did with him and Ellie. I don't think any fan does, but I like that they tried. You know, I think that's Joe Johnston trying to do something different, whether or not it was him or a writer or just, you know, something thrown in, or if it was an early idea for Jurassic 3 to have them broken up. But it is almost heartbreaking to see, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because at the end of the first film, you're like, oh, well, that's... He realized what he wanted, and he still hasn't got it in JP3.
Yeah.
He never got kids. He never progressed past digging up old bones.
You know what? See, that's the problem, though, is it does kind of ignore a lot of Grant's character development from Jurassic Park, and it kind of throws it out the window. It is a really cool twist on his character, but at the same time, I feel like it does kind of ignore some of his own personal growth.
Yeah. See, I would say this, though. In the Lego Jurassic World game, Billy probably had the best ability because he had that little hang glider kind of thing.
Yes, he did. That was actually pretty fun.
So you could, like, fly from, like, treetop to treetop and whatever.
Yeah, no.
That was awesome.
You know what? The Lego game, the JP3 parts of the Lego game were definitely better than the JP3 parts of the movie. Yeah. They made it, they even changed it up in a way that it's, like, it lent itself to a story structure a little bit better. It seemed cooler, and it also had, like, some interesting takes on, like, the dialogue that I felt like the story development that kind of made it mesh a little bit more.
Yeah. That would have been amazing, yeah, like you said, if they delayed JP3, and then...
Or went in for reshoots.
Sorry.
Or went in for reshoots.
Yeah, that would have been interesting, and surprising that they didn't, if they were editing it and thinking, hang on, this really isn't a Jurassic movie. Well, you know, I don't know. It's surprising.
You know, there's probably a lot of factors going into it, which is a cause for concern for Jurassic World Part 2 as well, is that chasing after that American dollar right there. You know, it's the almighty dollar.
Obviously,
just push it through.
Obviously, that is something that, you know, well, these movies, they do have to be financially successful, especially because they cost a lot of money. And when they have the potential to make money, it does make sense to say, hey, look, this movie franchise can be huge. These movies can be huge. We should really be hitting that target. So, I mean, I'm not cynical in the fact that it's like, oh, they want to make money with it. Well, yeah, that's kind of the point. And they've got
it's a business.
They've got to.
Understand that.
I think that the years of development.
Oh, Nate! Oh my god, I can't get past the 50% tunnel.
I think the years of development.
I got like 6,000 coins now, man. All from the first 50% of the level one. Like,
dude, well, how many do you have? 60,000?
No, just 6,100.
Oh, 6,000. Hey, you're close. You can buy a new dinosaur soon.
Oh, really? Oh. Yeah. Okay. What's the 10? Is
that
10,000?
I don't remember. Do we make it 10 or 20? It changed so much, like, over and over again. Hold on.
Okay. It's stressing me out, man. I've been playing it this entire podcast.
No, man. Yeah,
I'm getting better, though. I'm definitely, like...
Dude, if you're hitting that tunnel consistently, once you get past that, it's going to be something else you're hung up on for a couple, you know, for a time. And a couple weeks. And then you'll get past it. Dude, you'll have it beat by the end of the day. That truly is the hardest part right there. In level one, in my opinion. Because you got to be patient and then jump 3 times consecutively. So... Anyways.
So hang on, can you remember that tunnel bit? So I fall.
Yeah. You kind of fall into it, wait, and then jump one. It's kind of like a boom, boom, boom. It's like methodically. It's not a quick
double
jump.
And I land on
the
platform. I land on the platform halfway through the tunnel.
Hold on, I'm going to play it real quick and tell you.
Okay.
This is going to be great radio or podcast, you know, audio.
Just us silent breathing playing Jurassic Jump. every 10 minutes there's me like screaming how
yeah
I've lost again.
Zach's Jack's making moderately or what sounds like sexual noises. Oh, and I'm dead. I can't talk and play at the same time. That's the main thing. You have to have like total focus, like like, you know, I caught myself like thinking ahead in the level, and you can't, like, you have to be like present in that moment, like knowing, all right, I'm knowing what your objective is, like right then and there.
Yeah,
otherwise,
it's constantly
you're
on the
toast.
Edge of your seat. This game, there's no safe zone. You don't ever feel safe.
right. I didn't talk about yet. I didn't talk about the challenge that we issued for everyone on across all platforms. I announced it last night in my YouTube live recap. There is a challenge been issued by us that whoever is the first person to beat all the levels. So you got to screenshot your game with a star next to, a star pops up next to after you've beaten the level. A star next to all 10 levels, you get an exclusive one-of-a-kind prize pack. I'm going to post about it later today on the internet.
What's in the prize pack, man?
We've got a couple of the Jurassic Jump tank tops, a phone case, a poster, but the $30 iTunes gift card, and or play card if you're on Android. And the best thing is a one-of-a-kind, I'm not joking, we're going to make one t-shirt that says Jurassic Jump Champ, and it's got all the characters across the front there.
Oh, so, nice. Proper unique.
It's going to be, and then, you know, we'll give whoever the shout-out, you know, wearing the t-shirt and whatever, as the Jurassic Jump Champion. So, yeah, man, we're going to push that out today. I'm hoping that, and that can be, if you pay to unlock all levels, the reality is you still have to beat every single level. You know, it doesn't, like I said, all levels are fairly the same amount of difficulty, with the exception to probably the last level, Extinction. It's damn
you
hard.
You'll never win.
this prize it, there's will like be like asteroids given away flying in at September. You.
Yeah, 2018.
Congrats to the winner, to the three people still playing next Jurassic June. Yeah. I bet someone will beat it within the end of the month. I have no doubt in my mind, because it's only been out for 2 days now and one day on Android, and multiple people have already beaten level one and two. So
I was gonna ask, do you think it will be by the end of the month?
I do think so. And you know,
getting a notification while playing, that could be
that'll be the killer.
Oh, I saved it. It's cool.
whoever comes out as the champion of all time will have the one of a kind exclusive Jurassic Jump champion shirt. So that'll be cool, along with a bunch of other prizes and stuff like that. Yeah, so
tell us about the rest of the month, man. Like, obviously, we're retweeting all the art and stuff and the games.
Yeah,
going
so
on,
we're
going
to do that. I'm going to be really, Jurassic Jump is the biggest thing. I'm going to be pimping it out like nobody's business. I'm
proud of this, man.
I am, man. It's been, you know, I've said it. It's been tons of work. So now comes the fun part to me, is all the marketing of it and just pushing it out. And so really hoping that this JP fan community really embraces it and then tells all their mom and dad and dog and aunt and uncle, or aunt and uncle, as Jack would say. Hopefully, yes, that's the... And so hopefully just keep pushing that out. We've got a couple other things. Like I said, some giveaways planned. I'm going to try and do those recaps every night. And so those will be kind of a fun element. In addition to, I think we're going to do a couple folks have been talking about doing a live commentary on Jurassic World, like watch through and record it. And
that's something that we've even been talking about.
I don't know, maybe Mystery Science Theater-esque, you know, just kind of knocking on it. We love it, but, you know, just trying to be kind of fun with it, you know, provide some humor to it. Just really anything we can do to get more content, more hype for all things dinosaurs. locally, calm down. It's going to be okay.
God, Jack's going to break
just,
his tongue.
It's just,
man,
I can't get past it. I gotta go to work soon, man. And
like, that's the other thing, is you're gonna have to find some bathroom breaks there.
You were gonna say about the commentary. That's a great idea. We've talked about doing something similar ourselves, and I think the one we were hyping up last year that we never ended up doing was the Jurassic Park 3 Drinkathon. where we'd watch JP3, we'd do a live webcast, and I think we got to do it this month, Chris.
We can make that awesome. Happen. We just need to figure out how to do a webcast.
Well, we can do... I was figuring out webcast last year, but and it's easy to do, but doing it with three individual cameras, or four, it would be in this case now, or maybe even five if we get Alex in, or six if we get Nate in, or seven if we... But you know what I mean?
Well, like, can we do a circulating feed where, like, one person's featured and then it kind of jumps to the others, like maybe the others are small?
Well, this is what it should be. It should have all... Well, say it's me, you, and Assis. It should have all three, but that's the difficulty getting it onto YouTube. But you'd have to buy software to be able to do three individual web streams that then sync into one video. And it was just, like... becoming a challenge. Unless we're all together, it makes it very difficult. And obviously,
you could probably do I don't know how it would translate, maybe look into it. Google Hangouts has a pretty good setup.
That's what I was looking at as well. Yeah. And I could play videos over my live stream, but I couldn't add another live stream in. There must be a way. But Chris, it's something we got to look into. We should try and do it by the end of this month.
Yeah, for sure.
Or you know, if Jurassic Park 3 was released in July, wasn't it? July 18th or something.
Was it?
Another blip in the bad category.
Yeah, but it was. I swear it was like July. It may be just in the UK, but we could at least, you know, aim for that date or something. But it would be cool to do it this June.
Yeah, you know? No, I think... you're right. July 16th.
Yeah, 16th. I think it was 18th in Britain. That's why I remember the date. But yeah, I remember like when we were going to do it last year.
Yeah,
I was literally about to order a bottle of Sam Neill's wine, and that was what that was going to be what I would drink. I was going to drink two paddocks, and I think Assis was going to be on the beer. Chris, you were going to be on shots, right, or something?
Yeah, I thought that.
Let's embarrass ourselves and let's watch.
Well, we do that every podcast, but
just with the addition of JP3, right?
I think it would be fun. I think it'd be silly, it'd be fun. Assis might get really heated.
He'd be like, this movie is the best goddamn movie ever. But yeah, I've never seen or witnessed Assis drunk, so
yeah, you know. It'd be...
Dude, I bet that's awesome.
I don't know, we've really got to get that done. I do want to do something for Jurassic
50%!
World. 50%!
I mean, oh, and I died.
We're coming up on oh my God. We're coming up on Jurassic World being out for a year now. And we got to do something for that. And then obviously, you know, I know on our end we've got, like, giveaway. We've got some content debuting on our website.
I believe we've got our giveaway, but we're also doing a collaboration giveaway with Jurassic June, aren't we, Nate?
We are.
Yeah, so...
To be announced.
We haven't worked out the kinks of that.
Yeah, we need to figure out a lot of the details. But, yeah, no, there's a lot of cool things coming. I don't know if you saw the article, but... So if you remember that Jurassic Park cartoon art that came out from William Stout last year, I got a hold of a story bible from it, an internal Universal Cartoon Studios story bible, and it's got the logo right on the cover of it. Escape from Jurassic Park is the name of it, and it details all 10 episodes, and it gives you like information. It gives you basically a rundown. It's not a script. It's more of like a detailed, spoiler-filled synopsis. Like, it just gives you the arcs that are supposed to happen. So it gives you, you know, a very good rundown and explanation of where the story goes. And we're going to be posting, you know, a breakdown of that entire cartoon later on in the month, once I actually have...
Yeah, so that's almost our own...
Yeah, and the only reason why I haven't posted it yet is because I have the digital files, but not on me right now. I originally had them, and I accidentally didn't save... Long story short, we're delaying it because it makes sense. So we're going to do it maybe, like, I think the first five episodes, then the latter five episodes. But it's also because I literally can't make the article right now, to be entirely honest. It's because it's not an option at the...
It's very cool, though. I mean, and, you know, this is an amazing reveal. I was saying to Chris last night, because I had another read of the article. It's something that every Jurassic fan has dreamt of seeing. Of knowing more about this cartoon, because we really knew nothing, and now, you know, we're finally able to bring it to the table, and it's just so incredibly exciting. And it's such a weird feeling, because we never got this. We came so close to a Jurassic Park cartoon which took elements from the book and the movie, and it was dark and it was mysterious and it kept that Jurassic theme, and we never got it. And now we're finally getting to see what it would have been about. And, you know, honestly, Chris, it's only a matter of time until we see the trailer.
I really hope so. I've heard rumors about it existing and where it exists. So just really hope that... I mean, if I were Universal, when that art went viral, I would have reached out to the artist and been like, hey, sell it, more power to you. But whatever you have, can you send us digital copies of it all, so in case we ever want to share or talk about it? Like, because that's the perfect thing to put in, like, a web feature, that they could just own it, you know? Be like, yeah, we almost had a cartoon back in 1993, and, you know, why not own that, you know, idea? Don't scoff away from it. Like, hey, most of these people at Universal right now have nothing to do with that anyway, so it would be really cool to do a retrospective. Besides, nobody's going to be bitter about it. It's 1993. It sucks it didn't come out, but at this point, just be like, hey, look, we got some cool stuff to talk about.
Yeah.
So is that as far as it got? Like, what you guys have as far as it got?
It had...
We know there's a trailer, and we know that...
The trailer was like a proof of concept trailer. Yeah. And we know that there's
probably
a lot of art.
Storyboards or something.
Probably not fluid animation.
There are some storyboards online from William Stout before he posted this artwork years and years ago, and I can't even find the original source anymore. He posted one or two pencil drawings that was like animation studies of the dinosaurs. So there's like some sauropods running, and then a pteranodon running on its legs and then flying. And it's different than the stuff that he's more recently posted. So in the past, he did post some things as well. So people knew the cartoon existed years and years ago, but it was like there was like two or three pencil drawings, and that was it. And this was like finally like the veil was lifted about the art style and the idea behind it. And so
it's very strange, isn't it? I mean, it would have changed the franchise. It would have gone a different direction.
Yeah.
If Lost World still would have happened the way it happened, but I think the franchise would be very different right now if that cartoon had gone.
Yeah, I mean, the idea behind it, I mean, you saw, like, it had a Mosasaurus, a Plesiosaur, like, I mean, it had a lot of really, really, really cool ideas, and I love the fact that they were pulling straight from the book, and I love the fact that, like, right there in the story Bible, it says, no, it's not going to just be a cartoon, it's going to be basically the same tone and seriousness of the movies, and it's going to have an art style that matches that tone. It wasn't going to be like, you know how like a lot of old school cartoons were like, you know, made for kids. This was like going to be a primetime animation series. So it's for everybody, but it's not like now this one's for the kids. No, this one's, again, like Jurassic Park, it was going to be like for everybody. So that would have been...
Man, it could have been on TGIF after Dinosaurs.
Yeah, it kills me. It was really close to happening, and it fell through.
And apparently it fell through because Spielberg was working on Schindler's List at the time, right? And really didn't want to... Oh my god, I've got past it. Oh shit. Oh, Nate. Oh, oh no! The bridge! Okay, alright.
Okay. It sounds moderately sexual, and I'm a little I'm a little confused right now.
I got past the Nate.
Bridge,
man.
Oh, the bridge! Oh, the bridge!
Oh man,
screw you guys! That was really.
Oh
hard.
My gosh!
I'm sorry. Hey, yeah, one apparently, thing. So Chris, I gotta stop playing now. We're coming to the end of this podcast, and I'm not gonna win.
That's all he wanted. He just wanted to say he beat it during the podcast.
Well, that's why I kept my goal more realistic. I'm like, by the end of June, level one.
Yeah, okay. I'll play the game
for the next 10 months and hopefully beat it by then.
So,
there was one other thing I was gonna tell you guys. We're working on. If you guys want to fly to Nashville, you should probably do that. Coming up in a couple weeks, and if not, I will live stream it. There's a local theater in a little town called Franklin down the way, probably 25-30 minutes from here, and they're doing summer Spielberg series, and so they're gonna do Jaws and Raiders and stuff like that. They're gonna do Jurassic one night. I've got a phone call here with a guy soon, but we are gonna sponsor that. And we're going to be out there with Jurassic Park vehicles, an Explorer and a Jeep, and some. I'm going to do like live trivia and possibly have a Jurassic-inspired cocktail at the bar. It's kind of one of those small theaters. Okay. It's kind of fun.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Man, yeah, that's awesome. That sounds
it's going to be really cool. So I will try and when I get that firm date, I'll post that and then live stream it. I've got to figure out a good place to live stream. Like Periscope was kind of last year. Like,
yeah, I was going to say Periscope, but it's kind of died out.
It kind of has, yeah. And I really like the YouTube one because it automatically puts it in a YouTube video. You can switch between, you can share your screen and you can share your, you know, different videos and different pictures and stuff like that. It's kind of cool. So I'll probably stick with that. I just got to pick one and stick with it. And I think YouTube's probably not going anywhere for a while. It's kind of a big deal. So
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, YouTube's getting there. I think Google's about to take it over. So we'll see some progress there. Nate, thank you for coming on, man. And we're going to have you on multiple times through the month. At least once more. Maybe when I've got to level 2 of Jurassic June.
That's Jurassic right.
But seriously, man, congrats on the game and congrats on creating Jurassic June, because it's something that everyone has got involved
with. And it's become so much bigger than you probably imagined.
It totally has, man. From last year being, you know, invited by Colin at the premiere, which I still like just kind of think might have been
an
awesome dream.
That was so much fun last year.
it all started just kind of as a joke. And so kind of here where we are now, just, you know, putting out a fun game and just doing, you know, it's
to
cool.
See everybody's
it's finally.
Wait to see who gets involved. Matt Winston's involved. Winston School of Character Arts. They post a lot of stuff for the 30 Days of Dinosaurs. And
it's cool, man. It's fun to see where it is and where it's going. And then, you know, next summer, hopefully we'll have some filming going on for Jurassic World 2. And
yeah, next summer is going to be a wild one again because it's Jurassic World 2 is going to be happening.
Except we're going to have to be relying on Jack to get all the information because it's going to probably be filmed overseas, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be filmed in Britain, so I'll do my best. I will do my best, guys.
I gotta get
you.
My passport.
You can just send Sean over there. Like, we just buy Sean, like, some plane tickets and just send him over like a pair of binoculars and a camera and like a ghillie suit so he can just like
he'll be fine, man. I know the story in Hawaii. Well, I know what he'll do.
God, I wonder if we could get him to
we'll get him to come on again. I think we gotta have him on this month.
Yeah
It's that was fun. And when I'm going to Hawaii in September, so I'll do a live podcast from the Valley or something.
Oh, cool.
Then and there, which would be sweet. But Nate, thank you so much for coming on, man. I got to jump. Cool. I got a Jurassic
jump.
You got
to jump out of here.
Yeah. Thanks for listening to the podcast, everybody. And Nate, good luck with the rest of Jurassic
Hey, guys, if you want, join 30 Days of Dinosaurs hashtag. Draw a dinosaur every day with the hashtag Jurassic June. I'm actually trying to do it this year.
Yeah, and also, you know, tweet your artwork, but also come to JurassicForums.com and post your artwork there. Chris has set up a thread there in the fan art section. So, Jurassic June.
See you guys later.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks.